Yes. Nice.
Grab you as well.
Yes. Are you named? Yes, sir.
But I have a good one.
Hey, how are you?
Everybody morning.
Morning.
Nice to see you. How are you?
Did you keep your copy? There's two now, separate things. Yeah, there's two different ones. I think you got
Right. Hey, Pam, how are you?
Good, how you doing?
I'm good.
Miss O'Leary.
How many more of
I didn't like Lynn, but usually I never hear back from her. So, I just assume she
I saw her somewhere.
How many more of
I can see you.
No, it does.
Yeah, that's
I think it's reserved for that. That's the boss.
Bobby will throw you out.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
Alyssa. I wrote a story about
it. I read it all.
It's part of reimbursable expenses.
Right.
He was getting it all.
I've been warned not to sit on your chair.
And then after that's done, we'll adjourn at 10 o'clock.
And then I'm stopping 10 o'clock. I don't have 10 minutes or anything.
That's where maybe the best place to
here.
Yes,
if you leave that in your office, you can
I guess This is what they do in every other.
That's good.
We need to rebuild our system.
Yeah.
So I didn't have any emails. That'll go to 10.
So what it rate?
Yeah, I'll make a copy of it.
Okay, that's fair.
Several steps, the first one.
That's what it should be, that's the distinction.
No, it's about here.
It's about here. Community gathering aspect of YMCA's.
They'll make the presentation. Yeah, you just read. I'll check with Billy.
I know she must be lost. There's always a change.
We do want them to make a presentation so that you can decide whether to adopt.
That's what I thought.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
they don't need.
No, no, that's just for everybody else to kind of speak about why they don't like it.
Okay, gotcha. This is presentation for us. Presentation for us. No, unless they're already here. Yeah, please. All right. We have a quorum, so we'll go ahead and start the meeting. Glad to see everyone here. The first thing we always do before we start the meeting is stand and have a pledge allegiance to the flag, so if you'll all join me. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Meeting will come to order. We have a quorum, so first item on our agenda is consideration and approval of the minutes of our last meeting of January the 19th, 2012. Has everyone had an opportunity to look at those? If not, I'll give you a minute to look and I'll await a motion that we approve.
So moved.
Second.
We have a move and second that we approve the minutes of the last meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All right, the minutes are adopted. Second item is the Secretary Treasurer's report. Tim?
I've got a report on three different accounts here. The first two, if you'll look at the very top under balance sheet, our operating account, we have $36,197.91. Not really any activity this year other than some interest, $21.51. The second page is the economic development account. We have $5,361.57 in that account, and we have accumulated $1.76 in interest.
Generous interest rate.
A very generous interest rate provided by the Citizens Bank of Forsyth County with four convenient locations. And the last thing, this is actually the January statement for the FEMA's account. As you'll recall, this was a special account and there's been no activity in February and there is a zero balance as of February. So what I did, I included what has happened this year, which is as of January 31st. You'll see we had, in the beginning we had $43,650 as of January 1st. They reimbursed for a wire transfer of $10, so there was $43,660. And then we sent a check in January to FEMA's when they properly presented their bills along with the consultation of Ethan Underwood. So we have zero in the account. The second page is just the activity that happened in 2011, which is the majority of the activity with the REBA grant program for the Themis's Incorporated Company. So that just gives a history of what happened in December, and I attached it to the January statement. But in by the end of January, and as I said, no activity in February, there's a zero balance in that. So.
We still have some more coming on that before it's finalized, don't we?
Ethan?
Yes, sir. There is a planned third drawdown. It's approximately around $120,000 left on it. It's a $200,000 grant from the state that Themis's is drawn down upon.
Okay.
But we do need to make sure we're cognizant of the timelines because they have till May of 2013 to perform all the requirements before to make sure or hit all the standards that have to be met in order to continue to qualify.
Okay. All right.
And the account is still open. What will happen? They'll wire that money in, and then when the invoices are presented properly for payment, along with the approval of Ethan's office, then we'll pay out the third draw.
All right. Okay. Anything else?
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Our procedure is to ratify the treasurer's report. So do I hear a motion that we ratify the treasurer's report? Moved by Pam.
Second.
Second. Have a moving second that we ratify the treasurer's report. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. And they are adopted. Item three is consideration of inducement resolution with respect to issuance of not to exceed $45 million of revenue bond financing for the benefit of Improved Living Town Club Windermere Assisted Living LLC. So I think at this time, we have Ethan, are you
Mr. Chairman, representing? I just want to just clarify for the record that typically, as you know, our firm is honored to be able to represent the benefit authority. However, as we declared the authority back in 2011, we have represented the developer of this project for the last 3 years and are serving as local counsel for the applicant. So we have a conflict of interest and we're not able to represent the development authority on this issue. The development authority agreed and hired Bill Holby from King and Spalding. He's here today, so we would ask that you consult him on all matters regarding this.
Okay. Bill, I think the people are prepared to give us a presentation on the scope of the project.
Yes, sir. Let me thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for the opportunity to assist you all on this particular project. It's a privilege to do that. I've enjoyed working with you all as bond counsel for many years, and so this is just getting to move to the other side of the table a little bit. But let me clarify a couple things in addition to the council distinction on this particular transaction. There was some question about the conduct of these meetings this morning. This meeting, this 9 a.m. convened meeting of the Development Authority, is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Development Authority. Its purpose is to conduct the normal business of the authority. One of the items on your agenda, as you indicated, is the consideration of an inducement resolution for which you received an application from Improved Living Town Club Windermere Assisted Living. So that application was received in good order a week ago. It was distributed to you electronically. You have hard copies before you this morning. So that's the purpose of the Development Authority. This is the item on the agenda for the Development Authority this morning. In addition, there was a second notice that was published in the newspapers calling for an additional public hearing at 10 a.m. That is a hearing that is required by the federal tax laws, and it's referred to as a TEFRA hearing because it was brought into existence through the Tax Equity and Fiscal Responsibility Act of 1982, more than you need to know. But this process has been around since 1982, and it's simply an opportunity to invite members of the public who might be interested in the project to appear at a public hearing and express their views about the project. That meeting is scheduled for 10 a.m. So the meeting of the authority at 9 a.m. is to consider the inducement. When this meeting adjourns, we will conduct a separate meeting. I will simply be a hearing officer. I'll record notes and as best I can, record the events at that meeting. So that's a separate public hearing that will occur at 10 a.m. Just wanted to clarify because I know there's some question about what was happening at 9.
and what was happening at 10. So now, for purposes of your meeting, you've received an application from Town Club Windermere about the construction of an assisted living facility here in Forsyth County. They have submitted a good bit of information to you about that project, and they also have a number of people here who are going to make a presentation to you to give you additional information for you to consider. At the end of that, there will be consideration of whether you should adopt an inducement resolution. Just for clarification, there's two steps normally that the authority takes. One is a preliminary step, which is today. That's an inducement resolution. It's not a final approval. It's a preliminary approval. It's an opportunity for you to agree in principle to finance this project based on the information that you had. If you agree in principle to approve the project, that simply gives them a green light to proceed with their financing transaction, and then they will come back to you for a second meeting, at which time a final approving bond resolution would be asked for consideration. That's the time when you would approve the issuance of the bond. So there will be a second opportunity to consider this project then. So with that lengthy introduction, I apologize for that, but to clarify, and I would just, Greg, Almquist, I think, is going to tee it up.
Thank you, Bill. My name is Greg Almquist, and you'll be hearing from several of us. This morning, Mr. Holby, Mr. Underwood, we said, what would you like to present? And they said that really what all of you like to hear is what we're all about. And what we wanted to share in a short period of time are really these things. We want to talk about, which I'm going to talk a little bit about, what is a town club? It's something that I think that really hasn't been shared, and we want to share that message. Then Norm Hansen, my business partner, is going to talk about why is that important to the county or any of you. There are new jobs that are created. What kind of salaries are created? The tax revenues that we will have to pay. Even though they're seniors, it's not as if they own it. So we are on the tax rolls. Plus you'll hear, based on the communities that we've already developed and successfully operate around Atlanta, 40 to 45% of our residents will come from out of state. So these will be seniors with dollars coming to your county to spend them, not just at Town Club, but all over the community. And then finally, Eric Floyd, as well as Tom Woodward with BB&T Capital Markets, they're here to explain the financing. But as, both Mr. Holby and Mr. Underwood have explained, they said this is a transaction that, although senior housing is new to you, the structure is not. He said you've done this before, and it's certainly something that Eric and Tom do every day all over the country. So if you give me a few moments, you know, this is where we'd like to go with what we are. In describing and understanding what we are, a place I'd like to start, and we do this with our customers, is really explaining what we are not. Some of you, I'm sure you've been to the Publix, but if you've seen this magazine, it's a free giveaway called After 55. Our community was on the cover in 2008. In the beginning of it, and you probably, I don't know whether you've looked at it, but you turn to a section and you have in your mind the vision of what's senior housing. When I ask that, a lot of people, I grew up in Indiana, but they have a vision of the old nursing home. This is the place you go when you get old, you don't want to go there, and you go to die. Well, that's not what our industry is today. We're living in a time when people are simply living longer than they've ever lived before. We have numbers that when you get to 80 years old, the numbers of centenarians around the country are just growing dramatically. By 2017, the demand for senior housing and senior-related services will far outweigh the supply in the country. But when you turn to this particular page, you find in the After 55, these are all the different categories currently of senior-related housing. Now, it goes from just real estate you own to maybe a manufactured home to, in this category, these are apartments. There's something called a community called Park Alpharetta. It's a senior community, but it doesn't have any additional services or amenities to it. Then there's independent living. Well, that's the category that's where most of our product is. It's a luxury updated product. It's where seniors go, and there are all the amenities are taken care of for them. And that's what we'll be explaining. But this is a care option category. This is where you're going to see not only now, but the most change in the next 10 to 15 years. We will have some assisted living, but But this is not nursing homes, and that's kind of important to understand. I'll be sharing some things with you. We call it a club level living. These are people that they still get around and walk. Maybe they need help with their medicine. They play cards. They love to eat. They go to the hair salon. They just don't do it as quickly as all of us anymore. Then there's a category of memory care. Unfortunately, memory care, which is the Alzheimer's, is growing and very quickly, and we don't know how to really curb that disease. But we have about 20 units of that, and in our partner that manages all this, they have a background at Vanderbilt and some very good expertise in that. Then there are categories called what we call a SNF, a skilled nursing facility. That is not us. That's almost a hospital. That's the old vision that we all carry of the nursing home, where we go and we can't get out of bed, we've broken a bone. We are not equipped to handle that. That's not what we do. That's a very highly specialized area, and those are special facilities called SNFs, and that is a facility, as I'll explain later. And then there's home health care. In this category is an interesting one called a CCRC. That's an acronym for a Continuing Care Retirement Community. And what those are communities where you move in and they usually have all of this, but they require a $300,000-$500,000 upfront endowment. Most of the people moving in have to sell their homes in order to do that, and then they have monthly fees that are much higher than that. Well, what we are not that. We have some assisted in memory, but we are not skilled. We're not that level. We don't offer that level of care. We're not just an apartment. We are a higher end lifestyle community, and we're not for sale. What we are, and this is something that we've come to call it in our industry, is we're gonna call it a SILC, which is an acronym for a senior lifestyle community. And if I may, if you can just kind of hold that thought, let me now begin to focus you on what we do. Let me go back to the senior. As a matter of explanation, this has actually hurt us, this title. Not us, but our competitors in the industry called After 55. 55 is the age limit. If you're familiar with, under the federal laws, you can discriminate based on age if you have people and there are certain requirements, but if they're 55 years of age and older. I'm 55. My wife is 3 months younger than me. She's going to be 55. But she's quick to remind me, Greg, I'm not after 55 and I can't qualify to live in your housing. The reality is we are not going to have people our age moving into Town Club. The majority of our residents move in are in their late 70s or early 80s. What will happen, our children are out of college, they're just becoming young adults now. We'll stay in our home for several years, but then in our mid-60s, we begin to look to downsize. And these are the age-targeted or age-restricted for sale homes. I'm tired of mowing grass and doing all those things, and my son's not here to help me, so that's what we're looking for. But then as we get older, and we begin to say, I don't want to fix the toilets, I don't want to do these things, I want somebody to cook for me, that's where independent living and lifestyle communities come in. That's an important distinction in all this. Now, with that, when we talk about what are we then, and where can you learn more about us? Our first community is the Lodge at Bridgemill, and I have these brochures for all of you. What I wanted you to have in these brochures were pictures. Many of them are of our residents, some are actors, but you have floor plans. More importantly, on the back, you have a website for these, as well as our second community, the Town Club at Peachtree City. In this community, we have independent living, which you'll read about here, and then we have assisted living, or what we call club-level living, that you'll read about here. Again, on this website, we encourage you to go here. You'll find videos, you'll find photos, you'll find information about us. This community currently is 80% occupied. We expect it to be 85% probably by the middle of the summer. This community, we have two sections. Our independent living is right now is 67% occupied. We have an assisted living that will open up at the end of April, and it's already 37% pre-leased. As you learn about it, and our manager that I'll be sharing with you, it was one of their top performing assets in the country. And right now they're the fourth largest manager in the United States. So it's been received very well. They've both been done very successfully. Now what we're all about, let me take it one more step. And if I may, is it Mrs. Tisdale? Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Well, I know for a long time I've been on a lot of your videotapes, so I'm glad you're here today. And I would almost encourage you, if you can't see this, take your camera off, because I know it's been difficult for you to get out and see our communities, but this is an important message that I want you and all of your people to understand and all you to understand.
Thank you.
Our first community, we designed and it's done well, 150. Our second, we took what we did here and we tried to improve on it. And please, just take your camera so you can get a look at this.
I'll do that after the meeting. Thank
you. Okay. Well, I want to be sure that we did it and get it all accurately. In 2009, we won two national design awards. This one was the top award for the best design from the National Association of Home Builders. If you're involved in the real estate industry, that's a very credible national group. Well, what they came, and one of the reasons we won this award was when you visit our community, we're proud of it. We haven't been able to buy a cup of coffee with any of this stuff, but it's nice to win the award and be recognized. But the dollars we spent are nicely done, but the common areas are comfortable. But then we took the dollars and we flowed them into the apartment units. We don't have these kind of ceilings. It's a solid drywall. We have crown molding. We have granite countertops, undermounted sinks, a lot of high-end appliances, features that they said we shared those dollars all over the community. You'll see a design in our site plan similar to what we're proposing here at Town Club Windermere. It's kind of an H configuration, only instead of this part of the building going this way because of the land, we had to put what we call a knuckle in it. In it, we then have a gorgeous pool. We have 15 fountains. When you look closely here, it's a saltwater pool. There are 9 underwater bar stools with a 20-foot granite countertop underneath a large cabana with a hot tub behind the fireplace and a putting green over here on the right. When we built this, and you can find pictures of this online and on Facebook, we kind of said maybe that was a little too much. It's amazing. We have a pool party, and it looks like a fraternity gathering with all these white-headed guys and empty margarita glass. Two people deep at the bar. This is the lifestyle, the amenity that is part of what we include there. In outside of this, this is a large fire pit right outside our dining room and our lounge area. Well, a big part of what we do is our food. The food in senior housing has got to be good. That's one thing. You live and die by whether you have good food. We have an outside group that does country clubs around the Southeast. They're professionals at providing variety and things in a special way. They do all of our food. And then what happens in this dining room is very interesting. People will come for breakfast and they'll come for dinner. But then at lunch, they're active, they're out shopping, or they're going out to eat, or they're playing golf, or they're going boating in this county, or whatever it might be. But then they come back at dinner and they want to say, well, how was your day, Bill? Well, how was your day? And let's talk and let's discuss. So this is where a lot of living and a lot of activity takes place. That's what this lifestyle is all about. Now, in doing that, back to what we are, the objective things are these designs. We learned here, we improved on it here, and then as we're coming here, we're learning what's working in each of these, and we're just making it better. We like to use the Starbucks analogy. We all have it when they say Starbucks, you have a vision of what it is. They aren't the same, but they're similar. And those are the pieces that we keep designing into these as they evolve. An important piece then is, well, how are you going to operate it? And who's going to run this thing? We know how to design these, put them together. Our management team right now is a company called Life Care Services out of Des Moines, Iowa. They recently acquired CRSA out of Memphis. Today, they're the fourth largest manager and marketer of senior housing communities in the United States. They have more than 100 communities. They're in China. They're also in Costa Rica. They have a CCRC in Columbus. our community in Peachtree City, and then they do Park Springs, which is the Isaacson community, the CCRC around Stone Mountain. This asset last year was their top performing asset of their 100 assets in the United States. They also, being out of Memphis, have a relationship with Vanderbilt. Vanderbilt has an advanced division dealing with just memory care and Alzheimer's research in the United States. They have a team of people that are just focused on this. So what we have is a group of people that right now they like the Peachtree City market, but when they've been up here, they say this is better than what they've already done well with in this community. They understand our residents and we've got a track record to prove it. So what we're trying to share and what we're bringing is something that you don't have in Forsyth County. There really isn't a community like this north of this in Georgia at the moment. We've got a great team, we've got great designs, but here's the piece that really makes the difference here, and that's the sense of community. We have, when Bill, and I'm gonna use you as an example, Bill, if I may, he introduced, he said, we are here with a senior living facility. We are constantly told we're a facility. When you have a home, you don't live in the Windermere community or the Cumming community, you live in a facility, you live in a community. When you move to Florida, you buy a condo and you're not in a facility, it's a condo. Well, for some reason, when we become seniors, suddenly we all say, well, they live in the facility. And you know, that's, we build water sewer treatment facilities. We have truck facilities, and I'm constantly telling our people, we don't use the facility, we have a community. Well, I take that a step further, and the reason I'm mentioning that and why it's so important is that's when you really understand what this is all about. The community is not just designs and things that create lifestyles, places where people that sit at this and enjoy themselves, places in the dining room where, in particular, someone's lost a spouse. They're lonely, they've moved here from out of state. Imagine when you went to college and you didn't know anybody. And all of a sudden you're there and you don't have friends, you have family nearby but they aren't there. Well, we got a place that they watch out for each other. In this brochure, and I wanna tell three stories and then I'm gonna let Norm continue. Here are some women, and I know three of them, and they are all widows, but they're happy playing cards. You'll find calendars of programs in here that we offer, and they leave them alone for about 2 or 3 weeks, and then they call up and they say, Mom or Dad, we'd like to come and see you, how you doing? And they invariably say, I'd love to see you, but you know what, I'm booked this week. I can work you in next week at 2:30 right after sittercise, but then we have something at 4:30, so you gotta be gone. And that happens, and that's a good thing. This gentleman is William. William is now about 89 years old. He was one of the first residents as we're building our first community, and Norm will tell you. William would come in this dining room when it was under construction. He'd stand there and he'd say, Greg or Norm, and he'd say, I just got one more question. I just got one more question. And we would answer. Of course, we're trying to get people interested. We're in this dining room, and he'd say, I got one more question. And I'd say, all right, William, what's your question? And he said, let's suppose Ethan's table's over here. Now it's like high school. And he says, well, this is where Ethan eats. He says, suppose I want to eat here in Ethan's table. What are you going to do about it? And I didn't really have an answer. And I kind of sighed like that, and I said, William, this is not a senior citizen center. This is not a Jerry Seinfeld script where you come and you do that. I said, this is a community. We work hard to seat you with Ethan and seat you with Bill and seat you here and move people around. And then when you visit our dining rooms, even though you see booths and things, they were all designed so that as soon as we have that problem, we just move all the tables. So the next day they come in and Ethan's table's gone. So it's time to seat everyone all over. Well, William, he likes it, he's moved in, and he's become now one of our greatest advocates. Well, in that area, and I say the importance of this word community, which really ties back to what we have. My parents came to visit. I'm living this, they're in their late 70s. And my mom and dad visited our first community, the Lodge. And afterwards, we've left, and my mom's in the back seat of the car, my wife's there. And my mom says, Greg, that was a beautiful facility. Well, I just bite my tongue. You know, it's my mom. So what do you say? Well, my wife, she turns and she says to Gail, my mother, she says, you know, Gail, we don't use the F word around here. So with that said, and I say that kind of tongue in cheek, but we use that with our marketing people. I don't know why, but somehow we grow up through life and then we become seniors and we're going to plant them in the facility. Well, what we do and what we're bringing, it's not a facility. The world of senior housing is not what probably most of us grew up with. It's a different world, and the town club after this one's going to evolve and be different. These things, and again, you get a good shot of this somewhere, this is what we're improving on, and this is what we want to bring. But then the really exciting things get to be people like this, and the stories that are told, and then the people like the William and these people that they're out we're going to your stores, getting involved in your activities and doing those things in the community. I hope that that helped answer what we are. Now, to bring it back to more of the financial side, let me introduce Norm Hansen to focus on really why this is important to the county.
Okay. Thanks, Greg. Well, I hope I can follow all that passion. I'm the numbers guy in our partnership, so I'll be talking about the what physical benefit we might bring to Forsyth and to the Windermere community. I would like to add on one thing that Greg mentioned was that before we look for a site, we first test the demographics. As you can see, we're located in Peachtree City, one of the highest demographics in the state as a municipal unit, a municipal entity. We also found similar demographics up here in Forsyth County, in particular Windermere. In fact, we consider some parts of our selection criteria to be as much as triple here in the Windermere community than what we're currently enjoying in Peachtree City. It's a fabulous community. We have a fabulous site. We're very excited about bringing an improvement to what won a national award back in 2009. One of the issues, or one of the key points about the product that we bring to the marketplace, as Greg pointed out, is we are service intensive. I have a background with Hilton Hotels Corporation many years ago as their development director. What we bring to this whole notion of real estate and to this community is a large dose of the hospitality industry. We operate 24/7 just like a resort hotel. Greg pointed out some pictures of our dining room and our cocktail lounge, and we've got so much services that as we're talking about here, that the new jobs will be created for this community are high compared to just a normal apartment type of community. We will have, at full occupancy, roundly 150 full-time jobs. And you say, well, how can that be? I mean, all you are is an apartment, you've got a restaurant. Yeah, we've got RNs, we've got assisted living aides, we've got memory care personnel and staff, we've got wait staff, room service waiters, pool maintenance people. Our maintenance staff is large by comparison to most departments. We've got staff 24/7 around the clock. So you can see with three shifts every day, we triple what most people are putting out in terms of management and services. So the number of jobs is enormous. We also, because of the size of this community, it's going to be a 200 plus thousand square foot building. The construction, which will take 12 to 14 months, we'll also have a large element of subcontractor employment. A lot of these people, you know, they may not be making a lot of money on the job, but they're going to be stopping at the Starbucks or the Waffle House on the way to their way to work. So what we call the induced benefit of jobs will go up too. We also have suppliers. Sysco Foods, they come every day with a load of food. That creates jobs. We're a source of employment for a lot of those people. We have all the suppliers for chemicals and pool supplies and all this stuff. Has a knock-on effect in your community economically, providing jobs and income. Greg pointed out that a large portion of our residents are going to come from out of state. The reason for that is that there is what we call here the engine. The engine is a large component of the adult children, people my age, Greg's age, some of you's age, who have elderly parents who might live in Indiana, California. And at the age of 75 plus, a lot of those elderly parents are making the decision to move back near their adult children. And I might add that statistically, it's the adult daughter who is principally the one that they will want to come back to be close to. If we could figure out where the adult daughters are, we'd be in good shape trying to figure out just where to put one of our communities. But the mere fact that Forsyth County, in particular, a 10-mile radius of Windermere, has had explosive growth in the 45 to 65-year-old age group. And we look at that, and we analyze it over a 10-year period, see what that growth factor is. And it's here, in numbers triple that of Peachtree City. So what I'm getting to is that 45 to 50% of our residents are going to be moving here from out of state, from way outside your county. But they're going to be bringing their income, their pensions, their investment funds. They're going to be putting it in local banks. And this also helps local economy. So because of the way we're structured, this is a luxury product. Our average rents here are going to be enough that we have to attract an affluent crowd to live there. So these are the people who are going to be bringing, you know, tremendous retirement assets to be invested within your community. Taxes. The real estate taxes going to the county of Forsyth, we anticipate that stabilization, which will be in about 2.5 years after we complete the project, will be north of $300,000 a year. So we bring tax revenues as well. Even though we're a senior community, because we are a rental senior community, seniors do not own what they're renting. It is owned by the ownership group that will pay taxes. So they will pay taxes. What have I left out?
I think just the dollars they spend in the community.
That's
40%.
Yeah. So there's a give back to the community. We're here because of the demographics. We're here because we think we can be successful in providing a luxury product like this in the middle of Windermere. That's our part of the return on it. What we're showing you right here is that there is a give back to the community anytime you bring a senior community like this into your community. So that's
maybe this is a good point that if you have questions about who and what we are, if you want to ask those of Norman and me now, then we can go more to the financing side with Eric and Tom to get into that. If not, we would invite you. Yes.
Have you got all the zoning issues, permitting issues, short of construction permits? Are all those things in place for this to move forward once you get approval?
Yes, they are. We were approved, as Ethan will explain, on December 18th, 2008. That was about a month after the financing world fell apart. And we've been trying to work through that financing world since then, but everything but our building permit is where we are. If not, then each one of the communities said, please bring your parents, your in-laws, and all of their friends and come and visit us. And you can come swim in the saltwater pool or whatever you like. But at this point, let me turn it over to, I guess, Eric, that can explain a little bit about the financing and the important role of BB&T Capital Markets.
I'll refer to Tom, sir, as needed. Good morning. My name is Eric Floyd. I'm with a group called Sugar Valley Capital Partners. We're registered municipal advisors, and in this transaction, we actually represent the borrower, which is Improved Living Foundation, or an iteration of Improved Living Foundation, which is a 501c3 nonprofit organization. It will be the fee simple owner of Town Club Limited. We're here before you today to ask for the inducement of a not to exceed $45 million bond issue. We don't anticipate it being $45 million. You always go a little above what you think you're going to need, so we don't have to come back and ask for more bonding capability. The bond will be broken up into two series. And the reason for that is that we have a large equity component. There's $42.5 million of total bond issuance that we probably see. 32.5 of that, roughly, I don't have the numbers in front of it, will be in a Series A piece, which Tom Woodward at BB&T Capital Markets has decided to underwrite. The other portion of the bond transaction will represent actually the equity, about $9.5 million of equity that Norm and Greg and the groups they work with are bringing to the table. You cannot have an equitable interest in a nonprofit, so the only way to evidence the equity's participation is to have this second series of bonds issued in a subordinated role to the $32.5 million first lien, which BB&T Capital Markets will be selling. So that's basically it in a nutshell. This is just a typical conduit issue from the Development Authority, a revenue bond, where it does not put the county or the Development Authority in harm's way at all fiscally. And I'll throw it open to questions, because that's basically the financing in a nutshell.
I don't think there's anything different about this project than any other tax-free bond issue we've done.
It is ye old revenue bond project. That's exactly right. I was involved with the mayor of the deal. And that's what the investors would do when they're looking to buy the bonds from Tom over there at BB&T Capital. Thank you all for your time.
And just to confirm the point, one of the important elements of a traditional revenue bond structure is that you're facilitating this transaction for a private borrower to access the capital market. So essentially, there's going to be a lender, there's going to be a borrower. It will be the borrower, the lender will be whoever is interested in buying these bonds. Because it flows through the Development Authority, they will get tax-exempt treatment on that bond, which means that the investors in the bonds will be able to receive a lower interest rate, which is a benefit to them, because they won't have to pay federal income tax on the interest they receive. That's the reason that they come to the Development Authority. There is no no state or local subsidy for this project. So one of the concerns always that I hear at any of these meetings is we just want to confirm that neither Forsyth County nor the City of Cumming nor any other public funding of any source can go behind this project. And the answer to that is without a doubt.
Thank you all.
Thank you. All right, you folks have heard the presentation. Is there any questions before we proceed to ask for a vote? If not, the purpose of this was to consider the inducement resolution. What we need to do is to vote to pass the inducement resolution, which basically says we would like this project to come into our county. And then we go through the other steps, next of which is the TEFRA hearing we're going to have here in a few minutes. Then it comes back to us for a final approval, then it goes to the county commissioners, or maybe I got those reversed. The county commissioners will approve it, and then the Superior Court will approve it before the bonds can be issued. So this is the first step where we say we think it's a worthy project. We want to induce you to come into Forsyth County, and that's the purpose of this resolution that we're going to consider today. So any questions about what we're doing? Well, if not, do I hear a motion that we adopt the resolution to induce this project to come to Forsyth County? So I'll wait for a motion.
So moved.
Second.
We have a move and second that we adopt the inducement resolution for the Windermere Assisted Living LLC project. All in favor, let me know by show of hands. Okay, unanimous. The inducement resolution is adopted. All right, we're running short on time. Randall has assured me he can talk fast and get through his presentation quickly so that we won't be delayed too much on the hearing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. During the last Development Authority meeting, I'll pass two documents around to you. During the last Development Authority meeting, the board had asked us to prepare just a quick synopsis of what we had
done and accomplished last year in terms of budget and a proposal for how to move forward this year. Moving very quickly, the first document that you have here, the handout, has a paperclip on it with a little tab on the far right side. You flip open to the second, third page there. It has our 2011 priorities. We had a very ambitious work plan last year, and I'm proud to say that we were able to accomplish everything that was within our plan. We were very successful last year overall in recruiting 1,016 new jobs to our community, worked on 16 economic development projects, and brought in $42.7 million in new capital investment, which was a tremendous year for 2011. Also, in terms of our budget allocations, if you take a look at the second handout that was passed out, it should be a two-sided sheet. The first side there just talks a little bit about our business perception survey. This was a great initiative that the Development Authority funded last year in order to determine the overall perception of Forsyth County's business climate and why business leaders were moving into our community. And we're proud to say that after surveying over 100 local businesses, 71% of the local businesses responded that they're very satisfied with our business climate in our community. And we also had a significant number report that they plan on moving forward with business expansions within the next 2 to 3 years, which is very exciting. In addition to that, on the other side of that same document, it talks a little bit about our trip to the Bio International Convention, which is the actually the world's largest biotechnology event. We were able to secure at this event 8 new prospects, and after meeting with them, 8 of those turned into 4 very accurate business leads, and we're working those leads as we speak still. It also helped us to develop a great relationship with the German-American Chamber of Commerce and the Japan-American Society, as well as the Japanese External Trade Relations Organization. Another major factor that we did, just moving very quickly through the document, we were able to launch new marketing material. The reason that's important is because we really do have a great story to tell, as our business perception survey demonstrated. Our businesses are very favorable of our low taxes here and also our great quality of life. And those are things we really have to put into our marketing material to help us to attract new companies. Flipping back to the original document, kind of jumping towards this year's goals, if you take a look at the tab there, the tab denotes the location of the 2012 work plan. And opening that up, you can see that we have several key target industries very in sync with where we've been and kind of what's moving forward. And I'll wrap this up very briefly. Data centers still remain one of the top groups that we're recruiting. Technology firms still serve as one of our most strong groups, but the fastest growing market within our community still remains healthcare. We're very positive and anticipating that we'll see tremendous growth in our healthcare market once again this year. But manufacturing is also beginning to return again. We've had several recent announcements in the manufacturing sector. And our second fastest growing niche market is our international sector, again with a strong concentration of presence of German firms. Next page there, and then I'll jump towards to the end. This year our goal, 1,100 new jobs, $40 million in new capital investment, and we feel that we can possibly exceed those already this year. We have been successful in creating 50 new jobs and $2 million in new capital investment, and we're still within the first quarter.
Randall, how does that compare with 2011?
It actually puts us kind of in direct sync with it, but the reason that these numbers are not significantly higher is quite simply because we want to factor for any mergers or acquisitions that we'll see. That's going to be one of the hallmarks for this year. Many companies that are going to come out of the economic downturn will begin to take a look at possibly acquiring other firms or merging in order to remain competitive. We've seen that several times in our local community. A great example is with Lafarge and Argos coming together, a French firm that is a concrete manufacturer here in our community. So 1,100 new jobs, relatively in sync, but that's to account for several mergers and acquisitions, which won't necessarily be new jobs, but will be jobs retained. And then if we flip very quickly to the last page, our proposal for this year calls for several key factors, including moving forward with establishing a database of all of our existing properties. We were able to secure kind of a snapshot of all of our available properties, but as we go forward, it's very critical that we establish a real-time database of what's on the market at any given moment. We've been very successful in identifying some software that can help us to accomplish that goal from the Development Authority. This also can help the Chamber with recruiting new businesses and help the Tax Assessor's Office with the county as well with getting real-time up-to-date data for properties. And as you can see, the allocation there covers a one-year subscription, and that goes year to year. In addition to that, we'd also like to make sure that we're increasing our outreach with our project managers. There's several new members of the project management teams at the Georgia Department of Economic Development. One of the key events that they co-host is the Georgia Economic Developers Association Conference, which takes place in September in Savannah. That would be a significant event to attend, just so that way we can make sure we have a presence and we're able to network with a lot of the project managers who are handling the incoming recruitment projects for the state of Georgia. The Bio International Conference you'll also see listed. That's another tremendous event that we were able to have strong leads from last year. We think that we can see some positive successes at that once again this year. And then red carpet tours. We're talking a little bit about our target markets. It's very critical that we continue to host tours that allow for us to promote our existing amenities to the key decision makers from the target industries that refer to, in particular, the healthcare market, data centers, and the international sector as well. We think those will really be significant in 2012. But sorry for speaking pretty quickly. Want to make sure we're respectful of everyone's time. Overall, you'll see the proposed budget here for $37,945. Want to also make a note, there are some other projects that we do have at hand that funding can be allocated towards. There was a discussion, I guess, in the previous meeting about maybe rolling over funding from last year into this year. If the board sees fit, we can always modify this in order to incorporate those additional projects. But want to make sure we present it just a fair and accurate overview of kind of where we were in 2011, our accomplishments, and then our goals for 2012, and then the budget allocations that are in sync with those goals.
Randall, I know we're up against the clock. I just have one quick question. I noticed on page 2 under the business perception survey outcome,
yes, sir.
71% of local businesses are very satisfied with our community. The other 29%, what was their biggest concerns?
They wanted a Cracker Barrel.
So that's taken care of now.
There we go.
Good answer. In all honesty, let's see, if you drop down to bullet number 4 under summary results, top concerns were taxes and traffic. As you know, as moving forward, there's several upcoming votes for our transportation SPLOS, the Transportation Investment Act. I think it's very reflective of kind of what our business climate is and what the community is expressing. There were some specific quotes from the data just about how traffic has impacted business retention and being able to retain a workforce. Also with our manufacturers delivering goods from our community down to the airport to their freight forwarders so that way they can reach cargo ships. That was key. But I think taxes and traffic were one of the factors. The other thing to bear in mind also is our community still also has one of the lowest millage rates within the metro Atlanta area. And the fact that taxes was referenced by our local businesses, that also demonstrates that there's a value in the new marketing material that we're presenting that we'll talk a little bit about really how we have a competitive advantage of having low taxes here.
Randall, I know there's much more in this than you were able to present today, so thank you so much for putting that together. We'll all look at it, and I know I speak for the authority when I say thank you for the passion you've shown for this community and what you've done and what you're going to do. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. You do a good job.
I think for today what we should do is vote to adopt or not to adopt the proposed budget in total. So we've got a working figure. But I'd like for everybody to take this home and look at it, and let's be prepared to discuss it a little more, maybe in specifics, at the next meeting. But we can go ahead and move forward if we see fit to adopt it. There may be, we might want to juggle some of these conferences around. We might want to do something different. But I think we need a framework of a total to work with, and then we can reallocate that as we see fit during the time. So I think we should adopt it if we choose to adopt it. on a basis of being kind of a loose framework that we'll get specific about as we go forward.
And if Randall comes back next meeting and he tweaks it a little bit, we can still look at doing if he needs to add something.
Sure. And I would say, just as an aside, I attended a meeting where the software presentation was made, and it's amazing to me the things that thing will do. It's a real-time system where you can look at every piece of rental property. You can narrow it down to a street or a section of the county or a highway. You can put all of your parameters in, and it will give you every piece of available space that's available for rent, what the rent is on all of them, so you can compare within that area. You can compare areas to other areas. It gives you a list of what's for sale, how long it's been on the market. It's amazing the information that it has. And I know the tax assessor's office said it would be a big help to them as far as being able to compile comps for appeals on properties and so forth. It's amazing how much information it gives you. I can't believe that they've got all that in a database, which they constantly update. So when you say real time, it should be within a 30-day update. If it hadn't been, it's going to be within 30 days. So I think it's an awfully powerful tool, and I think we probably get our value out of that. Of course, if we do this, we certainly need to look at and evaluate it next year based on our experience and our use. But I can see for a company coming into the county that says we're going to need 10,000 square feet of space and room to expand, etc. Man, you can punch that thing in. It'll tell you all the different choices. So it's a powerful tool, and I'd like to see how it works if we go forward with that.
Mr. Chairman, I'm not quite certain whether our representation affects what our recommendation ought to be at this time. So I'll also ask Bill, what I would think, if we are still handling the Development Authority schedule, I'd recommend, and if Bill concurs, that the Development Authority go into recess in its regular meeting at this time and convene the TEFRA hearing, just so we're in keeping with the advertised hearing time.
Okay.
And then that way we can reconvene afterwards if you want to continue to cover any of the business.
Well, I think this is the last thing on the agenda. Does anybody have anything else they want to bring up? Well, for the sake of let's complete it and reconvening, we just need to vote on this one issue of adopting the budget for next year, proposed budget. So I'll await a motion that we adopt the budget as presented by the resident.
So moved.
We have a move.
Second,
that we adopt the budget as presented for next year. Any discussion, questions? All in favor, raise your hand. Okay, unanimous. The budget is adopted for next year. Do we have anything else before we adjourn? If not, I hear motion we adjourn.
Motion.
Second. Motion and second, we adjourn. All in favor? Meeting is adjourned. Thank you for your attendance.
We'll commence the public hearing in 60 seconds, so anybody who would like to stay, feel free to stay. Otherwise, you're free to go.
Anybody needs to make a break for the restroom or water or something, please take a minute at this time.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. I'm coming to see you Monday.